light is found in you alone. Your grace, a well too deep to fathom. Your love exceeds the heaven's reach. Your truth, a fount of perfect wisdom. My highest good and my unending.
There we go. Good, 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 good. All right. All right. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Good morning.
Good morning.
Rusty, good morning. Good morning. All right, man. We are super excited this morning. Today is VBS Day. Are you guys excited? Oh, yeah. I feel it. All right. So this year is all about in the wild. So this is about as wild as I can get, I think. So, is it enough? Is it enough? All right, I'll stop here. All right, so we need your all's help, though, because VBS can't happen with just me. So we need a lot of volunteers because VBS is so, so important to so many kids and to so many even volunteers. It's such a big deal to everyone who's involved. So we are asking for your help. There are lots of ways you're going to help. You don't have to do this, I promise you. You don't got to do this, okay? Bob, you're sad about that, I know. All right, if you guys will look in your bulletin, all right, on the back of the connection card, there is a place for you to fill out your name, give us your phone number, your email, and then put where in an area you would like to help. All right, so we have teacher spots open, all right, and we have different spots that are open, and then you can put your age preference there as well, which age group you would like to help with. So we really need a lot of help. So if you are interested in being a teacher, if it's something you've kind of thought about and you're like, I'm not really sure, just put your name down and we can have a conversation about it later. But we need a lot of help. So please don't be shy. We love all the help we can get, all the volunteers we can get. Now the fun part. You guys ready? I need everybody. I'm going to pray for us, but I'm going to need everyone to stand up. And we're going to do our theme song. We're going to do our VBS theme song. And I'm going to come out there with you guys, and we're going to do this theme song together. We have our lovely VBS worship team who is going to help us with the motions so you can watch them. I'm going to be out here with you guys. So let's pray, and then we're going to get VBS. We're going to get excited. You guys ready? All right, let's pray. Lord, Dad, thank you for this day. Thank you for this amazing congregation and for this time we have to come and worship you. I pray you'll bless this day and bless all who are here. We love you, and it's your name we pray. Amen.
Well, that is a new one for me, worshiping with a giraffe. Before we get started here with some more worship, I just wanted to let you all know the fine cellist that you heard is a good friend of mine, Nick Martin, maybe a new face to many of you all, but so thankful. He's a student at Taylor County High School, an incredible musician on both the cello, saxophone, and other things I may not know about yet. But anyway, Nick, thank you so much for coming and playing with the choir. We appreciate it. Got a new song for you today. We hope that you'll sing right on as soon as you learn it.
Okay.
has found a resting place, not in device nor creed. I trust the ever-living One. His words for me shall be. I need no other argument. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me. My heart is leaning on the Word, the living Word of God. Salvation by my Savior's name, salvation
grateful this morning that I received that power when I believed on His name. How about you?
Blessed be the name.
Let's pray. God, thank you so much for today and for this opportunity that we have to gather here and worship you. To worship you through not just through the words that we say or the words that we sing, but where our hearts connect to your heartbeat and to your passion. God, during this experience, may we open our hearts and our eyes to see this world in a way that makes our hearts break, because your heart breaks at the lostness and the brokenness around us, and that we will be your hands and feet as we go into this community and love people. And God, as we take up this offering, as we give back to you, may you take this offering and bless it so that we can do that as a church, to reach into this community, to reach into this state, this country, and this world, to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. If you want to go ahead and please be seated as the ushers begin to take up the offering. If you want to come to Kids XP, children, if you want to come meet Jeremy down here, maybe he'll wear his giraffe here in just a minute as you go on to XP.
Stirring as we pray and seek. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I know I say it every week, but I mean it every week, how much I am going to miss being here with you all and the worship experience. I want to thank you for all of the encouragement and affection, the cards, the gifts that you presented to me on Wednesday night. It means a great deal. While I am definitely going to miss you, and I pray that many of you all, if not most of you all, will miss me. I always think that's a good thing. I think it's sad when there is a separation and a going of two different directions, and nobody misses each other. I had much rather be missed, and know that you all will be missed as well. 2 weeks from today, I will do what God brought me here to do some 18 months ago. 2 weeks from today, I will take this baton and place it in the hand of your new pastor, formally signifying the passing of the baton from one pastor to the next. So I have this Sunday and next Sunday to preach, and then once I pass the baton, I'm not literally out of here on that morning, but I'm done. It's all up to your new pastor on that day. It's up to Dwayne. So I'm going to find a place to put this so it doesn't roll off in the middle of my... That won't work. Susan won't like that, will she? All right, it'll stay there. Okay. So I thought as we began our worship this morning, Jen, as you and the music team led us, the words in the first song that we sang, Great Things, today I am hoping to bring you words of encouragement and challenge. I hope and pray that over the coming decade or so that we as a church, that you all as the members and many more to come like you in the next decade, I hope and pray that you're willing to step out in faith and take some risks that you might not do otherwise. And one of the, as we sang that this morning, I thought how that first song encourages us to remind each other, Sister Jen, that God has indeed, truly, authentically, magnificently, miraculously, all of the descriptors that I can think of, He has truly done great things in us, through us, and for us, on our behalf. And I don't want us to forget about that. Hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Has He not done so in your life if you are a follower of Jesus Christ? You've done great things. And then He moves off Baptist, historical Baptist practice. He says, you will dance in your freedom. Yes. Yeah, that used to make us a little nervous. Not so much anymore. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. You've been faithful through every storm. We're going to consider a storm this morning in which one of God's people was willing in the midst of that storm to step out in faith and take a risk. I pray that as we finish up our time together, as we deal with maybe the uncertainties of what the new pastor will bring, I want us to face our doubts and our fears and genuinely get excited about what God is going to do here in this church and among us. Do you ever doubt? Do you ever wonder? Do you ever doubt as to whether or not things will work out in life, in church? Do you ever wonder if things might ever be the way they once were decades ago? And my suggestion to that, my response is, that's highly unlikely. It's a different world in which we are functioning today. I'm not saying it's a better world. I'm saying it is a far different world. What we're talking about this morning is dealing with doubt, facing our fears, responding to the promises of God. Max Lucado, whom some of you have heard, you've seen him preach. Lucado wrote a book 8 or 10 years ago, and the title was one word, fearless. The subtitle was, imagine your life without fear. Fearless. Imagine your life without fear. Just ponder that just for a moment. Imagine maybe what your life would be if you had no fears. Lucado wrote, as he prepared that book, he said, there must be in God's great world a soul who has never doubted God's existence or questioned his goodness. But that soul is not writing this book. Nor is that soul standing here on this platform. I have had to face fears and uncertainties in my life, as many of you all have as well. Yesterday in Louisville, if you're a Louisvillian, and even if you're a Campbellsvillian, I was talking to Les Chadwick. Les and a few of you others ran the mini and the marathon yesterday. Les ran the marathon, and he's here this morning. That's no small miracle. I participated in the marathon, Mike. I did. From the comfort of my easy chair on split-screen television. Oh, I enjoyed it so much. On one side of the screen, I watched the runners. And I used to do the mini marathon. I walked the mini marathon. I never ran it. I never tried it. I was always smarter than that. But on the other side, I watched the annual Kentucky Derby hot air balloon race. For 25 years, some of you know, my wife and I and my kids, we flew hot air balloons all across the United States. The last balloon that I had, as a matter of fact, was a spectacular 105,000 cubic foot hot air balloon with a beautiful logo, multicolor rainbow, Celebrate Jesus on the side of it. We took it to churches and camps, convention meetings all over the United States, and we were really blessed with that ministry for a good many years. We don't fly balloons anymore. I enjoyed, however, my hundreds of flights, but I always had confidence when we would lay out that balloon on a beautiful, hopefully calm morning, and I would open up those 22 million BTU burners with that fan forcing the cold air into the mouth of the balloon. I always had confidence that those burners would not let me down, Kenny, once we got at altitude. I always had confidence that the systems were going to function as we were told that they would. I loved to fly. Oh, I loved to fly balloons. I love to fly in small planes. Big planes are okay, but I love the sensation of flying in small planes. A few years ago, I was out west in Southern California, and there at Torrey Pines outside of San Diego, there is the Torrey Pines glider port. And it's there on top of the cliffs, Charles. They're above the Pacific Ocean, which sparkles blue right beneath those bluffs and cliffs. And from that glider port, they launch sailplanes. They've done it for nearly 100 years. They have what they call paragliders, which are parachutes with propellers on them. And if you're really brave, you can ride one of those paragliders in tandem, and you can fly out over the bluffs over the Pacific Ocean with nothing but a wing and a propeller behind you. And if you're really brave and maybe a little crazy, you can fly a hang glider if you're practiced and if you know what you're doing. And one of the spectacular sights that I always enjoy when we go out to that part of the world is watching those hang gliders, watching those hang glider pilots take a running start and leap out over the Pacific Ocean. You think they doubt? You think their faith in their practice, in their experience? They didn't start out necessarily flying out over cliffs. Maybe they started off of a levee, off of the backside of a dam down at Sardis, Mississippi, but now they're ready for big time. And when they step out in faith, believing that aerodynamically constructed wing of sorts is going to safely allow them to ride the currents of the air, it is spectacular. If you've ever been there, you know of what I speak. When one is taking such a risk, perhaps to hang glide off the bluffs at Torrey Pines, you have to put the what ifs behind you. And an experienced hang glider pilot will tell you that you have to purely focus on your experience and what the wind currents are telling you to do. There is no place for what ifs. But in faith walk, in your life and in mine, there occasionally creeps doubt. I wonder what if. I wonder how this is going to work out. I thought as I drove down here this morning, I told the group Wednesday night, many of you know, on tomorrow morning, and I'll be here two more weeks, but tomorrow morning I start a new position with my old camps. 20 years ago we started Crossings Camps, and I start in development with Crossings tomorrow. And my role is to find resources, human and financial resources, that will allow us to get where we believe God is leading us to go for the next 2 decades. And it's going to take lots of resources. But even with my confidence that God calls me to do this, I wonder, how well is it going to work? How am I equipped to do this? Doubt begins to creep in, and what I have to do when that doubt creeps in is remember the call, that God calls me to do this. And what I want to suggest to each and every one of you here this morning, on the verge of the arrival of our new pastor, you're not here by accident in this body of believers. That God has placed you here. In a sense, God has called you to be a part of this congregation. And as we deal with the story of facing fears today as a follower of Jesus Christ, facing the doubts and how do we respond, I want you to remember that God has placed you in this place for a purpose. If you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 14. John Ortberg, matter of fact, pastored out in the Southern California area. Ortberg wrote a book. Some of you may have seen it. Some of you may have done a study in it. Here was the name of the book: If You Want to Walk on Water, You Got to Get Out of the Boat. If you want to walk on water, you've got to be willing to get out of the boat. And in Matthew chapter 14, we see the story of Jesus and his followers. We see his followers in a boat. A storm comes, and Peter is willing to get out of the boat. I want to set the stage just a little bit. In Matthew chapter 14, there is a rather gruesome description of John the Baptist, who has been beheaded and his head placed on a platter at the wishes of Herodias and brought to a grand party. Look at verse 6, Matthew 14, verse 6. On Herod's birthday, the daughter of Herodias danced for them and pleased Herod so much that he promised her with an oath to give her whatever she asked. Prompted by her mother, she said, "Give me here on a platter the head of John the Baptist." And the king was distressed. But because of his oaths and dinner guests, he ordered that her request be granted. And he had John beheaded in the prison. His head was brought in on a platter and given to the girl who carried it to her mother. John's disciples came and took his body and buried it. And then they went and told Jesus. So they tell Jesus what has happened. And the next passage tells us his response. Upon hearing of the beheading of John the Baptist, Jesus withdraws by boat privately to a solitary place. And this is the story of the feeding of the 5,000 that we know. Fishes and loaves, is, if you will. Ends up in verse 21. The number of those who ate that day miraculously was about 5,000 men besides women and children. And we pick up the text this morning. Stand if you are able this morning and read along with me. Matthew 14, verse 22, in honor of the reading of God's word. And if you're not able, God certainly understands. But we read, immediately after this, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side of the lake while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, I'm reading from the NIV, that would have been somewhere approaching dawn, somewhere between 4 a.m. and 6 a.m. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. You got the picture, you know the story. And when the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said. I doubt that they said it with such composure. In my mind, they look and they see it and they scream, "It's a ghost!" Because they responded in fear. Verse 27, but Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid. Lord, if it's you, Peter." Oh, the tempestuous Peter. Peter replies, "If it's you, tell me to come to you on the water." And Jesus grants the request. Come. He didn't say, "Peter, you come on if you'll be careful." He just said one word. What was it? Come. Hey, this is not rocket science if you're Jesus. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. And when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they climbed into the boat, the wind died down, and those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Let's pray. Father, grant to us through the power of your Holy Spirit this morning, grant to us the capacity to more fully embrace, understand, to live by your word, which challenges us and encourages us at the same time. And Father, as the one to whom you have given the privilege on this day, I pray that you would truly be glorified as a result of this hour of worship together. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Most of us here this morning live where Peter lived. We have authentic faith. But if the truth is known, most of us also have an authentic faith that sometimes wavers and falters just a bit. I'm not talking about losing our salvation or anything like that. Most of the times when we encourage, or when we encounter, not encourage, when we encounter a strong prevailing wind in our faces, we may tend to falter just a bit. We may wonder, we may doubt. Charles Spurgeon said about those moments as he talked about Peter getting out of the boat, when he talked about Peter's prayer. Peter's prayer was, what was it? It's right there. Peter says, Lord, save me. Spurgeon said, sinking times are praying times with the Lord's servants. When you and I typically begin to sink, we typically, hopefully our auto response kicks in, and our default tendency is to utter a prayer. But Spurgeon also said about this passage, when you find yourself facing difficult circumstances, when you find yourself in an unexpected storm, in an unexpected position, he said this, Spurgeon, Charles Spurgeon, the great Charles Spurgeon, he said, sometimes short prayers are long enough. Sometimes short prayers are long enough. Years ago, more than a couple of decades ago, back in the early days of our ministry, and I don't remember where Pam and I were when she picked up this quote, but one of the ladies in one of our Sunday school classes one day said to my wife, who was the pastor's wife, she leaned over and leaned into her one day and she said, honey Pam, remember, no is a complete sentence. Because Pam was getting so many requests for her presence and her time, and this lady said wisely, honey, understand, no is a complete sentence. In other words, when somebody comes to you and asks you something that you're not comfortable doing, just learn how to say no. Peter did not have long to figure out an eloquent prayer. He says, Lord, save me. It's not length, but strength that is desirable. It's not length, it's a sense of need within us that we are calling on the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Peter is so very human. Turn over to 1 Peter. Turn over toward near the end of the New Testament. 1 Peter chapter 1. Hebrews, James, 1 Peter. This is the same Peter that uttered the brief but appropriate prayer. In verse 3, Peter writes, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he's given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, which is kept in heaven for us, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Look what he says beginning in the 6th verse. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. And these have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine in faith and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Peter has an extraordinarily strong faith. But the thing I love about Peter, he never lost his humanity. He was real. He was authentic. Peter had a strong faith, but in his humanity, he gets out of the boat. He gets out of the boat in faith, brothers and sisters, and then he watches the waves come. It has been preached and said by some, and I'm not saying that they're wrong, that the gist of this passage in Matthew 14 has to do with this, that once Peter took his eyes off Jesus, he began to sink. I'm not saying that's wrong. I'm saying that it's not enough from my perspective. From my perspective, with all respect to those who might see it otherwise, for me, this is about Peter's faith. His willingness to step out in the midst of the storm at the beck and call of Christ, who comes with just one word, and that word is come. And Peter hears it. And what does he do? He comes to the one who calls him. The relationship of fear and faith. Last week, we went to the empty tomb. It was Resurrection Sunday. Far as I know, this is the Sunday after Easter Sunday. As far as I know, Jesus is not back in the tomb, is he? No. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. And he walks with me and talks with me along life's wondrous ways. The ladies went to the tomb without a lot of hope, but believing that the body would still be there. Turn back to Luke chapter 24. Luke 24. Oh, the ladies in this story. Pick up the text in verse 36. This is post-resurrection Jesus. While they were still talking about this, they being his disciples, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." And they were startled and frightened, thinking they had seen a ghost again. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. The belief of those who saw him and touched him. He presents to them the call and the words of peace. But even then, so close, so very close to Jesus himself, there is confusion and doubt and some fear. The women at the tomb have conquered their fear, and eventually the disciples conquer their fear as well. But there along the road, more fear. And the text tells us very clearly that even his disciples were startled and frightened. They thought they were seeing a goat. Why do you doubt? Why do you doubt? And the question for you and for me this morning, with all that God's Word has given to us, the accounts so vivid, so clear, why do doubts arise in our minds? What I hope this morning is I only get one more shot at you Oh, I hope Brother Dwayne will have me back at times when he can't make it, but so I won't be gone for good. But I want us to deal this morning with the doubts and the fears and even the wondering. The Word of God, the promises of God of which we begin to sing this morning from the moment our worship services begin. Almost everyone here this morning has lived to one extent or another according to the promises of God. The God who cannot and does not lie. The writer of Hebrews says, because God wanted to make the unchanging nature of His purpose very clear to the heirs of what was promised, He confirmed it with an oath. God did this so that by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie. And we who have fled to take hold of the hope offered to us may be greatly encouraged. And you and I have this hope as an anchor for our soul. So in the weeks ahead and the months ahead, when things may not be going perfectly the way you expected, remember, this is a Baptist church after all. Seldom do things work as we expect them 100% of the time. But while remembering that we're not a perfect people, far more than that, remember the promises of God that cannot fail, that God cannot lie, that He calls us, He places us, He allows us to participate in ministry with Him. One of my favorite passages regarding God's promises and His presence. We know about His promises, but His presence. Old Testament, the prophet Isaiah, chapter 43, if you want to go there. But now this is what the Lord says, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. Oh, I love that. Fear not. I've redeemed you. I've called you by name as a Christ follower, and you're mine. When you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. How and why is this? Verse 3. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Remember His promises. Count on His abiding presence in your life and in this place, but also call on His power. Call on His power. I'm going to close next week with the same passage of Scripture that I began with 18 months ago. I don't expect you to remember, don't expect you to go back, but I'm going to end up where I started. It's not going to be the same sermon, so I do want you to come next Sunday because you haven't heard it before. I hadn't even written it yet, so I'm not sure what I'm going to do. I just know what I'm going to do with what text. But to call on His power. Paul writes regarding Abraham in Romans 4. Abraham did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but he was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had the power to do what He had promised. Oh, do you believe? Do you doubt? Do you have any doubt? Don't minimize the power of God in your doubts and in your fears. He's all powerful. It's sufficient power He's provided for us through the Holy Spirit. And like Ortberg says in his book, in the weeks and years to come, be willing to get out of the boat and heed the call of Christ to come. Don't play it safe. Don't stay in the safety of the boat. When Christ comes, when He calls, when He sends, get out of the boat and go to Him and follow Him. Have you ever done that? Are you here this morning? Have you ever gotten out of your own boat and answered the call of Jesus Christ to come? Every week at the end of our service, we offer a time of response. And this moment is for those of you that are here that have never responded to the call of Jesus Christ, the one whose resurrection we wonderfully celebrated last week, the one who died upon the cross on our behalf, paid the ultimate price. He gave His life for us, for you. If you've never accepted the forgiveness that can be found in Christ Jesus for whatever it is that encumbers your life, whatever it is in your life that you know God does not approve of, forgiveness can be found through the sacrificial death in the person of Jesus Christ upon the cross. And the opportunity is here for you this morning to respond to Him. I'm going to pray. We're going to sing. If you're not sure of your relationship with Jesus Christ, get out of the comforts of your own personal boat this morning and come to Him and experience the fullness of life and His promises and His power that are real. They're as real as me standing here, and they're infinitely greater. Pray with me, and then we'll sing. Father, we bow our heads before You this morning. God, for those that are here that have never responded to the opportunity to come and receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, God, we pray that today would be the day. Father, they may be out there in that boat of life. Maybe their lives are being buffeted by the waves and the storms even right now. Maybe they've been in those storms for a long time. Maybe the storms just started. They didn't see them coming. Lord, would You show them on this day the hope that they have in You, that You will never leave them or forsake them once they come to Christ as Lord. God, bring those that You would have invest their lives in the work that You're about here at Campbellsville Baptist Church. In the powerful name of Christ, we come in prayer. Amen. Thank you, church. Stand and let's sing together. have a seat just for a moment, church, as God continues to work. Will was going to bring announcements this morning. One I know of, particularly Brother Brad, is that immediately following the service, we have the Mason Biggers Luncheon in Fellowship Hall, right beneath us. So let us urge you to participate in that. I want to say one thing while Will is out. I didn't want to make his face turn red. But I thought I'd seen it all until I saw Jeremy on the platform up here in whatever that was. And then I knew I've not seen it all. It's not over with. But I want to say what a joy it's been to work with your children's minister and your youth minister, Jeremy Litton and Will Burgess, and the job that they do and their dedication with the students, the kids that you all entrust to them. So I was going to interrupt him and thank him up here, but he's gone. Brad, what am I leaving out today? Come on up.
Yeah, today, right after the worship service in the youth area, there's a youth mission trip meeting about all the details about Dolphin Island that'll be at the end of June. And so if you're going on that trip or if you have a child going on that trip and they're not here, but just go to the youth area right after the service and meet up with them. All right, well, everybody stand. And then I know everybody needs lunch. And so if you haven't smelt the biscuits and the gravy and the sausage and the country ham and the eggs and pastries, you'll need to go downstairs. All right, let's pray. God, we thank you so much for today, a day that we have come and been at your feet to experience you in a new and different way. And so, God, as we have experienced you and you have touched our hearts and if you we have encountered you, we are forever changed because we have seen you. And so, God, as we go from here, let us share that good news with all that we meet. In Jesus' name, amen.